What sets Bitcoin apart from other currencies like Euro, Ethereum, or US dollar?
Well, it's a very good question. Bitcoin is very different from traditional fiat currencies. First of all, it's supranational, so it doesn't belong to a specific region or even country. No one controls it. It's decentralized, and by being decentralized, it's very, very hard to change it. And one thing that's important to not change is the limited supply of at most 21 million Bitcoin. So it's non-inflationary, or at least a little bit inflationary until the 21 million limit is reached. And the fiat currencies are inflationary, and they're controlled, and you can easily get cut off from your fiat currency, from the bank account, and that's very difficult / impossible with the Bitcoin wallet. So it's your own money, you control it, and fiat is not really your own money, especially when it's in the bank.
And what advantages led to Bitcoin becoming a dominant standard?
That's a big question. Dominant standard is, you know, sometimes when there's technologies competing or systems competing, there's many, many outcomes. Many established themselves. Sometimes one is becoming a dominant standard. So the example would be Windows in the operating system of PCs, or with like Android and iOS, there's a dual standard, but many, many others went away. So the key function long-term of Bitcoin is to be a good store value. And today, it's very hard to have a good store value. The fiat currencies are not a good store value, with like 8% inflation. And then people choose something else. They buy an apartment, they buy stocks, they buy gold, they buy bonds. So a good chunk of the traditional asset systems are being used not for investment, but for store value. And so if Bitcoin became, which it is, the dominant store value, it would mean it could become very big. You know, we don't know exactly what the chunk of stocks and bonds and real estate is that are being used for store value, but it could easily be 100 trillion. Over 20 million Bitcoin, roughly, would be 5 million per Bitcoin. So the perspective could be really huge. So what makes one technology become a dominant standard? It's network effects. And network effects describe a logic that the more someone uses a technology, the more useful it becomes. And that could drive a technology to become a dominant standard.
Very interesting. I think you already mentioned it. But what role do network effects play in the Bitcoin network, and how do they affect the network directly?
Yeah. So just to explain network effects, I think it's really important to have some easy examples. So if you have a car, and if other people also own the car, the benefit you have from the car doesn't change. So it's still the same car, it drives, and it brings you from place A to B. If you have a communication network, and if you're the only one using that communication network, it's useless. And then if there's another person using it, it's of very limited use. You can communicate with one more person. And the more people use a communication network, the more useful it becomes. So that's a direct network effect. And with operating systems, you have complementary products, and that's an indirect network effect. The more people use Android, the more apps you have for Android. And the more apps you have for Android, the more useful it is, because you need apps for an operating system to be useful. And Bitcoin is a network technology with many, many network effects. And that so the more people use Bitcoin, the more wallets you have, the more exchanges you have, the more know-how you have, many, many direct and indirect network effects. And I do believe that the network effects are so strong that I think we already have reached it. We have a continuous adoption process that's feeding itself. And if they continue to be strong, the network effects, then that's the mechanism how it could become the dominant standard.
What is the problem with inflation?
It's huge. It's a huge problem, and it has many, many very negative effects. So first of all, there's an estimation of the M2 worldwide money supply is like 80 trillion. And if we estimate worldwide inflation on average at 5%, might be higher, then 5% of 80 trillion is 4 trillion purchasing power that's being lost every year. And 4 trillion, that's the German economy. So the value lost through inflation worldwide is as much as all the Germans produce in a year, 4 trillion. And and so that's a huge problem by itself. Huge value being evaporated through inflation. But then there's other problems. I think one problem is really important. It's very hard to escape inflation. So if you have, if you're wealthy and smart and educated, you know how to invest in a way that the return is at least as high as inflation. If you are poor and maybe not so much educated with financial issues, investments, you cannot, you don't invest. You keep the fiat currency. So inflation fully affects the not so wealthy part of the population, and that's a huge problem. And it divides society, and it could be as bad as creating not only unrest, but revolutions. So before the French Revolution, there was a very strong inflation. So it tears apart, in Germany 8 years ago, 1923, a huge inflation that laid the foundation for what came after that. So very bad effects on stability, but also for democracy. So keeping inflation in check is preserving democracy. I think it's a really, really important issue, and social peace and social fairness.
Why is Bitcoin the good and perhaps the best store value?
Well, it's in my mind, the best store value, because it's not really limited to 21 million, but it's transparently limited. We do know exactly, because we can check in the blockchain, how many Bitcoin are issued and on what address they sit. It's pseudo-anonymous, so we don't know who owns those Bitcoins, but we know someone owns those. And even with gold, we don't know how much gold there is in the world. And we don't know how much gold might be found on Earth or somewhere in space on an asteroid flying around. So gold so far was the best asset to store value. But it's not, because we don't know how much gold there is and how much gold there might show up. And since the last halving a week ago, the inflation rate of Bitcoin is lower than the inflation rate of gold. Gold is like 2%, 2.5%, and now Bitcoin with the halving fell below 1%. So it is still inflationary, but very little, and we exactly know roughly every 4 years that the inflation rate gets cut in half. And there's no other asset in the universe that we know that has these properties. Also, Bitcoin is digital. It's easy to hold, and it's very easy to transport. So if you have a ton of gold, it's very difficult to store. It's expensive, and it's very expensive to transport. And Germany is one of the largest gold holders in the world, and half of our gold is outside of Germany, because in an emergency, it allows us to quickly sell the gold if we need to. But no one knows if we would get it back if we ask for it. And that risk doesn't exist with Bitcoin, because you can hold it, control it yourself, and easily transport it around the world in 10 minutes.